welcome everybody to the second installment of the Mary L. Thomas Lecture Series. The Thomas Series is a new venture put on by the Department of Sociology and Anthropology. Another of our new adventures this semester is the launch of our research center on violence. And so in honor of our new research center, headed by Walter de Casaretti, this year's Thomas Series will focus on speakers who are experts in the study of conflict, crime, and violence. Today's lecture is co-sponsored by the College of Law, who've been kind enough to host the event in their space. And we owe a special thanks to Professor Anne LaFaso for helping to organize the event. Our guest today is a truly remarkable individual. Sociologist Donald Black first made his mark on the field through his work on policing. As a graduate student, Black rode in the back of patrol cars, watching officers who thought he was actually there to study criminals and not themselves. As a result, Professor Black was able to observe law in action and to see firsthand the extreme variability in how legal cases are handled, how the law was applied differently in one neighborhood than in another, and in one case than in another. His papers on the topic of policing have gone on to become highly cited classics and have been reprinted literally dozens of times over the years in various readers and edited volumes. Professor Black could easily have had a successful career as an expert in the study of policing alone. But like any great scholar, he was in the hunt for bigger game. He sought to create a general theory of law that would explain differentials in the handling of legal cases at every stage of the legal process in both civil and criminal cases in every known legal system on the planet. Furthermore, he wanted his theory to be distinctively sociological, to explain variation in the handling of legal cases without reference to the personalities or preferences of individual people. He unveiled his new theory in a book called The Behavior of Law, a modern classic that has since been translated into Chinese, Russian, Portuguese, Indonesian, and Farsi, and that continues to inspire empirical tests and celebrated debate from scholars around the world. Here again, Black could have rested on his success and been an expert in the sociology of law, but instead chose to pursue an even more ambitious project of producing a general theory of conflict management. Recognizing that law was only one way in which people handled their differences, he sought to explain such behaviors as avoidance, vengeance, private negotiation, and other aspects of handling conflict. You can find much of his work on these topics in his book, The Social Structure of Right and Wrong, available in English, Spanish, and Chinese. His latest award-winning book, Moral Time, is a general theory of why conflict occurs in human relationships, why some behaviors are considered deviant, and why some offenses are deemed worse than others. This brief overview provides only hints of Professor Black's level of ambition and creativity. We are extremely fortunate to have him here today. Please give a warm West Virginia welcome to Professor Donald Black.
Thank you very much, Jason. You'll see that he gave part of my lecture. It will be a nice introduction to what I'm going to say, because I'm going to be going through some early stages of my work to begin with. But anyway, first I want to express my sense of great honor and pleasure at being invited to be the second lecturer in the Mary L. Thomas Lecture Series. I rarely receive honors this big. It's also been great to come to West Virginia, to drive through the state for the first time, and see the beauty of it, and see beautiful Morgantown. It makes me even wonder about, I'm sort of a little unhappy about the secession, to tell you the truth. But get over it. God, you don't realize you left my state. Few subjects, it seems to me, are more important to humans than violence, and yet are so poorly understood, particularly scientifically. I think it's almost a scandal how little scientists have managed to learn about various kinds of violence and why they occur. So today, I'm going to try to say a few words about the beginnings of an approach to violence that I'm making. I'm going to focus on one type of violence, violence self-help, which is the handling of a grievance with aggression. I'm going to focus on violence self-help by individuals. But I'm not going to jump right into this. I'm going to first spend a little time going through the stages of my work that really led up to this work on violence. I realized that after I was well into the preparation of the lecture that I probably should have called the lecture Steps to a Theory of Violence rather than Violence at Social Time, because I'm not going to get to violence until fairly late in my comments. So I want to start by introducing you. I just want you to see the logic of the social logic of my work on violence as it grew out of my earliest work, strangely enough, on law. So the first stage I'm going to talk about is my work on law. Then I'm going to say a few words about the second stage, which is my work on how people handle conflict without law. And then thirdly, my new theory of why conflict occurs at all. And only then, only after that, will I try to show how these strands come together into an effort to understand violence. As Jason said in his introduction, one of my central concerns in my work on law, which did begin in a police car when I was observing this phenomenon, namely the subject of why it is that legally, technically similar cases are often handled differently by everyone who handles them, whether citizens when they're deciding whether to call the police, or police when they're deciding whether to make an arrest or write an official crime report and do an investigation, whether a prosecutor, a judge, a jury, hold constant the nature of the case, such as the technical aspects of a rape or the technical aspects of an assault or a homicide. And there's dramatic variation in how the cases are actually handled, which I know a lot of you are law students, and this is something I gather is generally not mentioned in your classes. But it's, I think, one of the most important features of legal behavior. So how did I try to answer the question of why technically similar cases are handled differently? And by the way, I call this variation in the quantity of law. What I mean by that is the amount of governmental attention or social control that a case attracts, so that an arrest is more law than a non-arrest, or a conviction is more law than no conviction, a more severe sentence is more law than a less severe sentence, and so on. So my question is, why does the quantity of law vary across technically similar cases? And the answer that I came up with from my observing police work, but also extensive reading on literature about the handling of legal cases, and as Jason said, from all over the world and also throughout history, insofar as information is available, the answer I came up with is that the amount of law a case attracts varies with the social structure of the case. And you all have a handout basically showing this. I didn't know that I'd be putting anything on board, and so I thought I'd better make handouts. I don't know if you really even need them now, because I'm going to just explain with this little diagram what I mean by the social structure of a case. If, say, A has a complaint against B, the core structure of the case, I sometimes call it the nucleus of the case, is the social location of A in relation to B. For example, how intimate is A with B? Say A is the victim of a crime. How intimate is A with B? I call this the relational distance between the parties. And this is why I'm starting with this early work, because I want to introduce you to what I call geometrical thinking about legal behavior and conflict in general. I actually call this a geometry of the case. I didn't want to inflict that on you right away because it's such an abstract notion, but I use different kinds, I talk about different kinds of social distance that a legal case or other conflict spans. So how much relational distance is there between A and B? And what other kinds of social distance separate A and B? For example, is there cultural distance between A and B? Are they members of different ethnicities, for example? A cultural distance is just a cultural difference. What is the elevation, the social elevation of A in relation to B? For example, is A wealthier than B? Or are they both, say, equally wealthy? Or is B wealthier than A? If B is wealthier than A, the complaint is upward. If B is less wealthy than A, the complaint is downward. If they're about equal in wealth, it's a lateral case. And every kind of social status is relevant. Well, I'm not going to try to list the kinds I look at. Relevant to describing the what I call the vertical structure of the case, which is how high or low each party is in relation to the other, how much social standing each has in relation to the other. So without going into other variables that I look at, these kinds of social distance and directions of cases have a powerful predictive, can be used to make powerful predictions, about how cases will be handled. I'm going to just give you one example. The first one I mentioned, the relational distance between the parties, or the intimacy between them. Here's a theoretical statement. Within a society, law varies directly with relational distance. Within a society, law varies directly with relational distance. What that means is the greater the relational distance, that is, the less intimacy between A and B, the more legal attention their case will attract. So, for example, if a rape is reported, A complains about a rape by B. If B is a stranger, for instance, A is more likely to call the police. And the police are more likely to handle the rape as such. And there's more likely to be a prosecution, more likely to be a conviction, and more likely to be a severe sentence if it's a stranger, as against, to take the other extreme, a spouse. If A complains about a rape by a spouse, some of you may know, it wasn't until about 50 years ago that spousal rape was even a crime in most states in the U.S. But it could be an acquaintance rape, or any rape that's between parties who are closer than strangers, the prediction would be less law will be attracted to that case. And that includes, as I implied a minute ago, the complaint by the victim. The victims of intimates are less likely to report their offenses to the police. And at every stage of the legal process, there's less likely to be an application of law if it's an intimate case. Even if it's a homicide, the homicides between more distant parties attract more law. You might not know that capital punishment in the United States is basically only for stranger cases. There is no capital punishment for intimates who kill one another, as long as it's just one intimate killing another intimate. I've actually never even seen one. There must be some in history, but they're so rare as to be negligible. Basically, capital punishment in the, 38 states or so still have it. Capital punishment only applies to stranger killings and multiple killings. I want to mention now that as Jason said, this principle, law varies directly with relational business, like all my other theoretical principles, applies, in this case, across all the stages of the legal process, to all kinds of legal cases, and applies across societies and history. It's so powerful in predicting how cases will be handled that I call it a law of law. Anyway, I want to say that it's just one example, and other kinds of social distance also attract more law. So the more social distance between the parties of various kinds, the more law is likely to be applied to the case. The one exception is in an upward complaint from a lower status person against a higher status person. Those don't attract more law, they attract less. But if it's a downward case, it attracts more, a lot more law. So I think that concludes what I want to say about law, but I want to sort of get you into the spirit of thinking geometrically about conflict. But after I got to a sense where I was sort of on top of the theory of law, I could refine it, I could elaborate it in various ways. But I became more interested in what I think of as one of the big findings in the sociology of law, and that is how rarely law is actually used. It's a funny thing to say, maybe in a law school, and I always feel a little awkward saying it when I teach my course called Sociology of Law, which incidentally I've taught in three different law schools besides a very sociology department. But the reality is that even if a case qualifies for the legal handling, if it's justiciable, I don't know how much people use that word anymore, it still doesn't predict very well whether the case will actually go into the legal process. And then, I estimate that as few as 10% of the crimes that people experience are reported to the police. The typical statistic on this is more like 40% or 50%, but in my view, that exaggerates, but still very low, but that exaggerates how often people call the police, because most of the time, they don't even define crimes as crimes. And the statistic that 40, 50% of the time they don't call the police, that applies only to cases that people say are crimes when they're interviewed about this matter in victimization surveys. So it's very rare for people, for even crimes, to be handled in the legal process. And then there are all the cases that don't so much qualify for legal handling. And this is a vast number of conflicts that occur in any given society. And so I became interested in the other ways that people handle conflict besides using law, and trying to develop some theoretical ideas about when they use different ways of handling conflict. We call this different kinds of conflict management, or sometimes we call it different kinds of social control. And the types of conflict management that are very common in all societies include, for example, avoidance, which is simply the reduction of contact between people. This could be the most common way that people handle conflict, some kind of social separation. It might be a coercive separation, and one person might be expelled or from a relationship, and basically told that the relationship is ended, or someone might be excluded from a social relationship. But most of the time, people just stop seeing other people, and they often will not even admit that they're avoiding the other person. The other person might say, "Are you avoiding me?" And say, "Oh, no, I've just really been busy. I've got a lot of exams coming up." But in reality, of course, they're right. They are being avoided often. And avoidance can be an extremely severe way of handling conflict. I'm not going to go into that because I want to try to get the violence, but I just want to give you a sense of another way that conflict is often handled. Negotiation, it's just talking things out, is another way. Third-party intervention without laws, like mediation or some kind of peacekeeping or Therapy also I consider a form of third-party intervention. The therapist is handling a conflict between a person and himself or herself. So people go to therapists because they have complaints about themselves, and the therapist helps them deal with themselves. But now we finally get to the subject that I want to talk about more today, as another non-legal form of handling conflict, and that is self-help. As I said at the outset, self-help is the handling of a grievance with aggression. And I'm going to only be talking about the handling of a grievance with violent aggression. I mean, if a person just criticizes another person, that's self-help. But I'm going to be trying to focus on the use of violence, meaning the use of force to handle a grievance. And as I said before, I'm going to focus mainly on individuals, but several of my colleagues and I have been studying self-help of all kinds, and glance at my notes here. Some of the subjects they've looked at are, I myself looked at this some time ago, terrorism. I don't know how many of you would think of that as a form of self-help, but terrorism involves a grievance, but it's handled by a group. And by terrorism, I mean the mass killing of civilians by organized civilians. And another example of self-help, again, I'm just going to mention these are collective forms of self-help, lynching. A lot of people think of lynching as it's itself a crime, but lynching, if you go sort of to ground level, lynching is a way of handling what the lynchers regard as deviant behavior, including crime. And so it's a form of self-help. Another example of self-help is, this is really a macro self-help, genocide. And genocide, again, a lot of people don't realize genocides are not just carried out, just to sort of clean out members of a population. What do they call it? Sometimes there's that other expression. Ethnic cleansing is sort of closely related to genocide. The genocidal people have complaints about the people that they exterminate. They have all kinds of things to say about how undesirable these people are, and that's why they want to eliminate them. So it's a form of, strange as it may sound to you, conflict management, genocide. And one of my colleagues has a book coming out on genocide using this theoretical approach. It will be called The Geometry of Genocide, be out in the next year. Another example of self-help that I myself have looked at in some detail is what I call the classic blood feud, which is an exchange of killings between groups. You're all familiar with the phenomenon, I'm sure. Member of Clan A kills a member of Clan B or some other group, family or homestead, kills a member of Group B, and a member of Group B then kills a member of Group A. And then a member of Group A kills a member of Group B, and this goes back sometimes for many years. There have actually been blood feuds recorded by scholars that have lasted, believe it or not, as long as 100 years. Blood feuding is very common historically around the Mediterranean ring. And last, I might mention another kind of behavior that you might not think of as a way of handling conflict, and that is a kind of behavior that's been studied by Jason Manning here, who introduced me, namely suicide. He's been studying the use of suicide as a way of handling conflict, a completely different perspective on the subject. It's not always conflict management, but a lot of it is. I use those examples partly because they all occur in different locations and directions in social space. The terrorism typically occurs upwardly against a higher status group and across a very long multi-dimensional distance. All kinds of social distance separate the terrorists typically from the people against whom they use terrorism. On the other hand, lynchings and genocide tend to generally are downward in direction, also across fairly long social distances. Blood feuds occur between equal groups, and the groups are somewhat close in a number of respects. For instance, they are virtually always between members of the same cultural group, members of the same ethnicity. And they occur at an intermediate relational distance. The members of each group can recognize members of the other group. And one reason the blood feuds, I think, are interesting and important is that I believe the model of the blood feud, the geometrical model of it, I have a multi-dimensional model with like 6 different variables that describes literally every blood feud I've ever heard about. That model basically describes what are called gang wars as well in modern urban American cities. Those are basically blood feuds. They're not perfect blood feuds in the sense that there's always a perfect exchange of killings, one for one, but they generally resemble blood feuds, which is why they have a lot of modern relevance, why the blood feud has a lot of modern relevance. Well, I'm finally to my third stage. As I said, I'm going to go through three steps before I get to violent self-help by individuals. Law, non-legal forms of conflict management. Now, the third stage is a theory of conflict. For years, I studied the handling of conflict, legal and other modes of handling conflict. And lurking in the back of my mind for years was the question of why the conflicts occur in the first place. Much of my early work started with the conflict. You know, someone calls the police, some kind of violence occurs, whatever. But the question is, why did the conflicts occur in the first place? Everybody knows that conflicts occur constantly in human life, in any kind of relationship that lasts any length of time, there's conflict. But amazingly enough, there is no theory in social science, or I should say there was no theory in social science that explain why conflicts occur so often and exactly what makes a conflict, what causes a conflict to occur. And Jason introduced this before, another way of putting this question of why conflict occurs is to ask, why is deviant behavior deviant? Why is wrongful behavior wrongful? Why is, say, criminal behavior criminal? Or why is crime criminal? Well, what is it about the behavior that attracts the label criminal or any other label that indicates that something is undesirable or condemned or considered bad? Also, what explains the rules that are said to be violated by wrongful conduct? The two ways sociologists always say, always use to explain why deviant behavior is deviant. I don't know how many of you have had a little sociology, but the two big answers they give to why something is deviant, why deviant behavior is deviant. The first one is, because it is so labeled. Deviant behavior is that which is so labeled. This is a famous statement sociologists make. To me, that is just a completely vacuous statement that says nothing whatsoever. And the question is, why is a given kind of conduct selected to be called deviant? Of course, deviant behavior is that which is so labeled. The other answer they give is because a rule is violated. That's why I mentioned rules a second ago. And there again, it's just totally trivial. Why is that the rule? An early criticism I used to get for my work on law was is you're leaving out the rules. You know, just looking at the social structure of the cases. And I used to say, well, I mean, first of all, to say this because a rule is violated is a trivial statement. But I don't want to address rules until I understand why those are the rules. I want to be able to explain the rules. So this theory of conflict that I've recently developed, I'm publishing a book called Moral Time, it at least helps to explain the content of the rules and helps us to explain what causes conflicts in general. And I'm going to try to summarize this theory very briefly. You have a handout that will be helpful for you in following what I said. Every human relationship, like every conflict, has a social geometry or social structure. So every human relationship involves a greater or lesser degree of intimacy or relational distance. Every human relationship has a vertical structure. One party in the relationship is higher in social status than the other party, or lower, or they're equals. And every human relationship has a cultural structure. The parties in the relationship are closer or farther apart culturally. There are, in other words, more or fewer cultural differences between the parties. So we can talk about how much social distance there is in any given relationship. And those various kinds of social distance, like if you look at your handouts there, you see, get to the punchline first. The changes in these distances, fluctuations in these distances in particular relationships, are what I call movements of social time. So an increase or decrease of social distance in any given relationship is a movement of social time. If you look at that chart, you see there are three kinds of social time. Relational time, which is an increase or decrease of intimacy between people. Vertical time, which is an increase or decrease of inequality between people. And cultural time, which is an increase or decrease of cultural diversity between people. Well, my big thesis in my theory of conflict is that the fundamental cause of conflict is the movement of social time. Fundamental cause of conflict is the movement of social time. If you look at the handout here now, you can see that I have broken down movements of relational time, vertical time, and cultural time into subcategories. An increase of intimacy is what I call over-intimacy. I should say right now that because you might wonder, does any increase of intimacy cause conflict? Greater and faster movements of social time cause more conflict. Greater and faster movements of social time cause more conflict. So the examples I've given here, to go back to over intimacy, for example, an increase of intimacy. My example there you see in the small letters under it is rape. A rape is a drastic increase of intimacy between the parties in the rape. It also involves coercion, of course. But the sort of sine qua non, coercion occurs in many situations, but the sine qua non of rape, the sort of heart of it, is this drastic increase of intimacy. That, by the way, is the first idea I got in this theory of conflict. I thought, if there's a theory that will explain what causes conflict, It should explain, for instance, why rape causes conflict. And it came as a thunderbolt to me when I saw that rape is a drastic case of an increase of intimacy. And I might mention right now, it's much a greater drastic increase of intimacy when it's a stranger rape than when it occurs between parties who are more intimate before the rape. It's a greater movement of social time if it's between parties who have no intimacy whatsoever before the rape. And I might as well just say right now, because I don't plan to mention this later, that's one way to explain why a rape involving a stranger attracts more law than a rape involving parties who are more intimate with one another. A stranger rape is a greater movement of social time. It's a greater degree of over-intimacy. Let's say parties already having sexual intimacy who have a rape between them experience there's less of an increase of intimacy there than there is between strangers. The same logic applies to all the other two major forms of social time and the various subcategories of social time. So you see on the chart, the second movement of social time is a decrease of intimacy. And I call that under intimacy. An example of that would be a desertion or abandonment, secession of the South from the United States was an example. I'm not going to go off into all the kinds of conflict that can be understood with this system, but under intimacy, over intimacy causes a lot of conflict, under intimacy causes a lot of conflict, and then vertical time involves, as I said, increases or decreases of inequality. An example of this I have on the chart is disrespect. But I should qualify that as disrespect between equals. If like two young men are basically peers, they're equals, and one puts the other down with an insult, disses the other one, as some say in the US, disrespects the other, insults the other in some way, I'm sure many of you know that those cases often result in violence. They cause a lot of conflict. Understratification is where the inequality between the parties decreases, and of course, drastically decreases, will cause the most conflict. The example I have here is rebellion. A rebellion is some kind of resistance to someone's authority. And of course, that causes conflict. And I don't want to get into cultural movements, cultural time in any detail, but you can see the examples there. Heresy is a good example of too much diversity. If you have one religion in a particular community or society, and someone comes up with a new religion, this causes lots of conflict. I mean, historically, in Western Europe, thousands of people were burned at the stake for deviating religiously from the status quo religions. And genocide is the most extreme kind of underdiversity. By underdiversity, I mean resistance to a cultural difference. Genocide is the most extreme kind of resistance because it literally eliminates the difference completely. Now ready to ask the question of what causes violent self-help by individuals. So the question is, what movements of social time cause violent self-help? You followed the question? I hope I've introduced this adequately. So actually, preparing for this talk, I thought I I want to try to use this new theory to make some kind of sense of some kind of violence. And so I basically tried to squeeze an answer out of this new theory. I call it the theory of moral time, by the way, the idea that movements of social time cause conflict. Again, what movements of social time cause violent self-help? Well, all of the movements of social time on this chart, all six of those cause violent self-help occasionally, but not commonly. What I propose is that the movements of social time that most commonly cause violent self-help, and you realize when I say violent self-help, I'm talking about what in criminal law we call an assault, including aggravated assault or homicide. The most common cause of violent self-help is a major movement of social time in a close relationship. And when I say close, I mean relationally close, vertically close, as between equals, it would be the closest, and culturally close, members, say, of the same ethnic group. There are two kinds of major movements in close relationships that I think are the major causes of violent self-help. One is when a close relationship loses its closeness. I'm going to elaborate that in a minute. When a close relationship loses its closeness, or under-closeness. And the other is when a close but unequal relationship loses its inequality, at least to some degree. Now, let me go to the first of those, when a close relationship loses its closeness. There are two main forms of this. I'm gleaning this partly from descriptions of domestic violence, including domestic homicides, and homicides in general. There aren't a lot of concrete descriptions of who kills whom under what circumstances, unfortunately. Sociologists tend to study these things with statistics at a distance from the concrete events of who actually uses violence against whom under what circumstances. But there is some material on it. And what I found is that, including material from other societies, is that a major cause of violent self-help, the first of the two major causes of violent self-help, of the loss of closeness, of close relationships, is a loss of intimacy. And particularly noteworthy is the amount of violence caused when women leave men. Like a woman announces she wants to end a marriage, or she just says she's just moving out. That plus unfaithfulness by women, sexual infidelity by women, those two forms of under-intimacy cause the vast majority of spousal killings, not only in the United States, but in all known societies where spousal killings occur. These are overwhelmingly the main reason. So in other words, under intimacy between close people causes a huge amount of violent self-help. By the way, I saw in an article the other day, something like National Domestic Violence Awareness Month. So there's quite a bit of information coming out about domestic violence. And I saw in the Washington Post recently that 3 women are killed every day in the United States. And undoubtedly, more than 90% are killed because they're either leaving a man or they have led the man to believe that they are unfaithful to the man. the second loss of closeness between close people that causes a lot of violent self-help is the one I alluded to a little earlier, a loss of equality between people who are relatively close. That this kind of conflict often qualifies as what is known as honor violence. The person, these are mostly, are overwhelmingly males, though females are getting into more and more of these kinds of conflicts in modern America with other females, including with, and also with males. One equal insults or otherwise puts down the other party, and the one who is put down defends his honor with violence. And the reason it's violence is that honor is a form of social status based on force. In order to defend one's honor, only force will do. There's an expression from like 19th century Italy, I believe, the laundry of honor is blood. Only blood can cleanse a person's honor. And this is why, you know, middle-class people in modern America often will say, well, you're about a young man killing another young man because he was insulted. I say, he's crazy. Isn't that crazy? These people have their minds. Well, they don't understand honor systems. Middle-class people have almost no honor. I finally got a laugh. It is true, and it's fascinating. And I would like to be able to explain where honor occurs. I admit to you, I haven't figured out why it is that it exists in some social locations and not others. But it's very widespread historically across societies. And it accounts for not only violent self-help on the street. I saw a case of it the other day. This is just within the last week. One of the best-known tattoo artists in Los Angeles, known as Triggs, T-R-I-G-Z, was sitting in a retail establishment, and another man said to him, "Where do I know you from?" And according to the article I read, the way you say, "Where do I know you from?" can result in a killing. Because if it's said in a certain way, "Where do I know you from?" He's looking at this person who's covered with tattoos all over his face and so on. Sort of like, boy, you are really something to look at. Well, the one covered with the tattoos who had that said to him immediately challenged the person to a fight, and before it was over, the famous tattooist was dead. He was shot. But I'm thinking of honor, and this is kind of a new idea, that honor violence is a proper way of understanding a lot of domestic violence. It's not just something that happens on the street. Take, for example, a case that received a great deal of attention over the last few weeks, the case of Ray Rice, Baltimore Ravens running back. You know, got a lot of attention because he was filmed striking his wife-to-be on an elevator, and she was knocked out, maybe hit her head on a bar in the elevator, whatever. And of course, there's been this huge uproar. He's been suspended from the Baltimore Ravens. I don't know if you've all heard everything that was reported about the case, but before that happened, before he hit his wife-to-be, there was an exchange of insults between the two, obscene insults. Then she spat upon him. I don't know whether she spat on his face or just on his shirt or whatever. And then she physically attacked him. Only then did he hit her. And I suggest he was defending his honor. I'm not, by the way, I'm not defending him. And hope you know that nothing I have said today was in any way a judgment about anything whatsoever. You think that's funny? I mean, why? Because you think I was? I've judged social science when I say they don't gather a lot of facts about homicides or whatever. But I haven't judged anything whatsoever today. I was not judging law when I said that the geometry of the cases predicts how much law cases will attract. I'm not saying this, and I mean, you might be judging. You know, one reason people think social science can't be value-free is that they make value judgments about what social scientists say, and then they impute those judgments to the social science. I'm quite serious. I have not judged anything whatsoever about human behavior today, about law or anything else, and I'm not defending Ray Rice or anyone else when I'm trying to explain what's going on. I'm trying to figure out what's happening. I realize other people don't do that very much. You know, so they know, you know, Ray Rice is just, you know, look at that animal. He hit this woman. Isn't that outrageous? You know, kick him off the team and so forth. Fine. I'm not interested in getting involved in whether he should be kicked off the team or not. I'm just interested in understanding what took place. Explain it. And I think it was a defense of honor. I think defenses of honor occur in domestic situations a great deal. I was just reading a case the other day in which this woman said publicly to her husband, "You're worthless." And she has made all kinds of insults about just what is a worthless worm he is. Well, he ended up killing her. And also any kind of exchange of violence between people. A lot of domestic violence, a lot of homicides occur not in patriarchal relationships, as is popularly thought, though they do occur in those relationships, but instead in relationships between relatively equal parties, whether they're cohabiting or married. And they get into these exchanges similar to the Ray Rice exchange of violence and insult, and one of them ends up dead or seriously injured. So again, I'm talking there about a way that a close relationship loses closeness, a loss of equality. My first example was, remember, a loss of intimacy. Now, there's a third scenario that leads to violent self-help, and that's a loss of inequality in a close relationship. That's where the patriarchal marriages are relevant, where the male has a hierarchically superior position in relation to the female and other members of the family, and if there is any kind of resistance to this, disobedience toward the patriarchal authority, you also get violence in those situations, including homicidal violence. The best examples of this phenomenon are in what are called family honor killings, in especially the Muslim world, the Hindu world to some extent. You get the most extreme cases in those two parts of the world where husbands very frequently injure their wives extremely severely and very frequently kill their wives. And for example, in Pakistan, there's a common phenomenon called stove burning. The husband or other male relatives pour kerosene on the woman and then light it. She burns to death, and they report to the police that it was an accident that happened while she was cooking. So they call it stove death or stove burning. The stove burnings occur, I can't give you an exact figure. I don't have my notes with me, but I would say they're probably, well, it's at least one a day in Pakistan, but probably somewhat more than. So that's sort of the extreme of violence occurring with a loss of vertical distance in a close relationship. I am now going to make a few concluding comments. I want to first note, or wonder if you know it, that that I didn't qualify what I said about the causes of violent self-help by time or place. I wasn't just talking about modern America. When I say something like most violent self-help occurs when close relationships have major movements of social time, this is not qualified to apply to the United States. It applies in general across societies. And I want to say it applies since the beginning of human societies, as far as we know, if we can infer from the behavior of hunter-gatherers. Now, human beings were hunter-gatherers, foragers, until only about 15 or 20,000 years ago, when the first humans were sedentary. So for the great bulk of human history, human beings were nomadic foragers. And those very simple societies, everyone is close to everyone else, relationally and vertically. There's no inequality in those simple societies. And they're culturally completely homogeneous. So virtually all of their conflicts, all of their major conflicts, occur because of movements of social time and close relationships, and specifically losses of closeness in close relationships. That is the major cause of all conflict, violent or otherwise, in the earliest simple societies. But the great transformation in human societies that's occurred since that early tribal period on until the present and is continuing has been growing social distances between people. The earliest societies are totally close. That's sort of the heart of what a tribal society is, closeness. But over the centuries, societies have come apart, and more relationships are between distant people. And that has also manifested itself in more and more conflicts between distant people. As those more distant conflicts occurred, law came into being and grew. If you define law, as I do, as governmental social control or an appendage of the state, then you see law didn't exist on a permanent basis until human beings became sedentary and started, indeed, having more distant relationships than the earlier societies. Law has mainly evolved as a way of handling conflicts between distant people. And the standard crimes are crimes, most of the crimes are crimes involving strangers. Burglaries, trespasses of all kinds, robberies, thefts, and the cases, of course, that law cares, that most legal attention is devoted to, are the ones between more distant people, as I said at the outset. I mention this partly because of the well-known idea that historically law replaced self-help. I trust most of you have heard this. It's commonly said that there was a struggle between law and self-help that was largely resolved in the Middle Ages when law prevailed, and that law has replaced self-help. Well, my view is that law didn't so much replace self-help, but instead law came into a new jurisdiction of conflicts between relatively distant people. Self-help is alive and well. It wasn't replaced. It hasn't disappeared. So recall now what I said at the beginning of the lecture, that more distant cases attract more law. And I suggest that the handling of the typical legal case recapitulates the history of law itself. They both occur, both increase. Law increases both at the level of the case and historically with social distance. Stop there.
about the comments you made about rape and intimacy. Rape and intimacy. I mean, there's two primary type of rapists. There's rapists for sexual gratification, those who would visit, you know, a child who's involved in human trafficking, the rape that's involved with, women who can't consent because of intoxication, and then we have the predatorial rapist breaking into buildings. And in that circumstance, it's more about dominance, control, and that's where the sexual gratification comes from. But in either scenario, I don't see where intimacy is involved in either way. Maybe I misunderstood the
sex itself is an intimate act. That's all.
Okay. All right.
And by the way, I don't impute motives to anyone. You said something about why they do it, and you
sure.
said talking about their motivation. I think I just want to mention in passing that nothing I said today ever addressed anyone's motivation for anything.
But isn't intimacy by its very nature? Isn't that a motivation of some type? Or
you could say there's motivation for everything, but I don't address motivation. Nothing I said today addressed what is in people's minds. In fact, this is something I thought could conceivably come up during the discussion. I wanted to say a couple of things about what I didn't say today. I didn't say anything psychological all day long. I also didn't say anything about people's purposes, which is, I think, part of what you were getting at. This is known as teleological explanation, where you explain someone's behavior as a means to an end, some kind of goal the person has. I didn't say anything teleological this whole hour. Nothing psychological, nothing teleological. And I didn't even say anything about people as such. Everything had to do with structures, geometries, and so on, and what happens in those structures, and what happens when there are changes in those structures. I just thought I would mention that, is what I've been engaging in here is a type of sociology I call pure sociology. This whole lecture has been an illustration of this. It's too bad it's new for you, but I'm sure it's very new. The whole way I was trying to explain things, it should be very new to most of you, because it differs from almost all sociology and other social science, which is riddled with psychology and teleology. The problem with it is, it's extremely difficult to know whether any of it's true. We don't know what's in people's heads. There's no way.